This old world is crumbling in moral decay. From truth and righteousness, we've gone astray. There's only one answer. It's down on our knees. It's time for all America to kneel and pray. Kneel and pray. Let's bring America back to God. Let's return to the path our forefathers trod. Whether at home, at work, or at school, let the Bible be our rule. It's time to pray and bring America back to God. As I look around me, little faces I see. I wonder what these children's future will be. It's time to stand up. It's time to pray.
Good, isn't it? That's what we need, all right? We're going to ready to stand. We're going to sing 131 together. That's our Star Spangled Banner. And you stand, I want to read something to you about the Star Spangled Banner. Of course, the National Anthem of the United States, written by Francis Scott Key, a deeply religious attorney. He was boarded on the British warship during the War of 1812 to negotiate the release of an American prisoner. He was barred from leaving the ship because the British were preparing to attack Fort McHenry, which protected Baltimore. He watched the rocket assault from the enemy deck. At dawn, Key saw the American flag still flying over the fort. The assault had failed. Gratitude to God welled up within him, and it was that sentiment which inspired his famous lyrics. As Sam Meyer wrote, commentators and political orators rightly refer to the Star Spangled Banner as a hymn because Key intended it to be. Amen. Unlike other national airs that exalt rulers or call soldiers to arms, Key's lyrics, besides being a paean of praise, was a prayer of thanksgiving to God for having saved the city of Baltimore from the damage the British had wreaked on Washington only 3 weeks earlier. Most Americans, we know the first stanza by heart because it's sung at all the ball games and different events that we go to. But we're going to sing both verses this morning, and I want you to particularly notice the second verse when he wrote, "Oh, thus be it ever, when free men shall stand between their loved home and war's desolation, blessed with victory and peace, may the heaven-rescued land praise the power that hath made and preserved us a nation. Then conquer we must, when our cause it is just, and this be our motto, in God is our trust. And the star-spangled banner in triumph shall wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave." Let's sing that this morning, shall we?
On that verse together.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly
this morning for part of the patriotic service. So you have the insert in your bulletin if you need help with those. I pray you wouldn't need help for the American flag, but you may need help pledging to the Christian flag and pledging to our Bible this morning, all right? We'll begin with the American flag, we'll do the Christian flag, we'll end with the Bible pledge, all right? And American flag, ready? Pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And then to the Christian flag. Ready? Pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag, and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again, with life and liberty to all who believe.
And then a pledge to your Bible. Ready? Pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God.
And let's pray together. Father, we bow before you in prayer now this morning. And Lord, we want to thank you for the founding of the United States of America. Thank you, Lord, for raising up godly men and men of character, men of decency, a man of integrity with which you founded this land, and we began well in America. And Lord, as we studied in Sunday school this morning, Jehoshaphat started well but didn't end well. And Lord, we see that coming for our country. And Lord, we pray as the choir sang today, you'd bring America back to God. Lord, we realize that America will never be great again until she's godly again. And I pray that we would put you back where you belong. We would center our lives and put you first. And so, Lord, I pray you'll bless our service now this morning. Focus our attention, and may our eyes be upon you. May you be pleased, and may Christ be exalted as we go through our service today. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Deep within the heart has always known that there is freedom. Somehow breathe into the very soul of life. The Thank you.
to 129 in your hymnal. 129. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. Battle hymn of the Republic. 129. Let's sing that first and third verse together.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vengeance where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible the sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never turn retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant at my feet. Our
couple announcements for us. Regular time tonight, 5:30 for our Christian growth class, and we meet in the conference room at 5:30. And our lesson tonight will be on our enemy. You'll find out once you become a Christian and you know Christ your Savior, you have an enemy. And we're going to find out about him. You ought to know who your opponent is and how you can defeat him. All right, his main objective is to keep you from being saved and keep you from ever knowing you're on your way to heaven. But once you are a Christian and you are on your way to heaven, he will do his best to fight you at every step to keep you from being used by God, all right? And so that'll be 5:30 tonight, 6:30 for our evening service right back here in the auditorium. And I'm going to speak tonight, Lord willing, on the subject to be used of God. What does it take to be used by God? And I think it'll be a blessing to you tonight. Hope you'll be back for the service this evening. And then 1 week from tonight, we'll have the tour group from Hiles Anderson College here with us, and you'll enjoy that music on that evening. Always enjoy it when the colleges send out their groups and travel. Always a blessing to us, and so we'll enjoy them next Sunday evening. And afterwards, we'll have some ice cream and some fellowship after the service and some volleyball and such. So you plan to be here for that. And by the way, wonderful, wonderful time at the picnic yesterday. Just a delightful time out at the Taylors, and a good volleyball game and a kickball game and horseshoes, and the kids had all sorts of things to do, and ended with fireworks in the evening, and great fireworks display, and just had a delightful afternoon and evening there, and appreciate so much the Taylors opening their property for us. All right. Well, it's All-American Sunday. Let's first recognize anybody here today for the very first time. I'm looking around to see if there's any very first-time visitors. Don't think I saw anybody. All right. We want to do a roll call of our states, okay? See how many states we have represented here in the service. And let's get Ohio out of the way first, okay? If you're from, if you were born in the state of Ohio, then you put your hand up, all right? Let me see your hand. Look at that. Great majority of people from Ohio. All right. Put them down. You weren't born in Ohio. Let's see, what other states do we have? All right. Okay, put them down. Put them down. I'll go around here. Just put you as I let. Let's do this section right here first. Anybody over here not born in Ohio? Right there. Kentucky. All right. Okay. Who else had their hand up? Brother Van Gelder? New York. New York is where I'd rather be. All right. Yes, Jackie?
Maryland.
Okay.
Dean.
California. I didn't know that. Huh. How many of you knew Dean was born in California? One person knew that.
One
back here?
Yeah.
All right. Two people knew that, huh? Well-kept secret. I don't blame you. But, all right. Middle section. Right here. Catherine?
Louisiana.
Okay. Yes, John? That's a foreign country, isn't it? How many West Virginians? How many West Virginians in here? Put your hand up. West Virginia. Good. One. John, you just said West Virginia. All right. But put your hand up. I want to count how many West Virginians we have. All right. One, two, three.
We got one of our deacons.
Of course, yeah.
The former governor of West Virginia is here, Brother Wallace. All right. Violetta?
Virginia.
All right. Okay. Leanne?
New Jersey.
New Jersey. That's right. Okay. Caleb? I can't hear you.
Tennessee.
All right. Good. Yes, Rachel? The big pencil. Pennsylvania. Okay. Yes, Felicia?
Colorado.
I did not know that. Isaac?
Texas.
David?
Florida.
All right. Oh, we got back here. Pete. Another Kentucky guy, huh? Okay. Over here? Kentucky. Another Kentucky? Wow. Okay. Charles?
Jersey.
Another New Jersey guy. Huh? Heather?
Arkansas?
Mike? North Carolina. You're a Tar Heel. I didn't know that. All right. Leland? Another Texan. Burchuk? New York. Cynthia? New Yorkers. Who else was New York? Ben Van Gelder was New York, weren't you? Okay. All right. Anybody in the choir? Anybody else?
Right here. Yeah. Wow.
Tanya?
Minnesota.
Minnesota, eh?
Yeah.
All right.
Minnesota.
Okay. Who else we got?
Larry.
Brett?
I'm New York, and the boys are Kentucky.
Okay.
Yeah. Still won't keep their shoes on.
Andy?
Hoosiers.
Indiana.
That's
John. Right.
Hoosier State.
Okay. Stay here.
Virginia.
Virginia. Another Virginia guy. All right. Wow. How about that? 18 different states here.
Wow.
Isn't that amazing?
Yep.
18 altogether.
All right.
So people get around, don't they?
Yeah.
And oh, what's this? Manual? What'd you wake him up for, Rachel? All right. Oh, you're born in another country. Honduras. Anybody else born in a foreign country besides Honduras and West Virginia? Anybody else all right? Wonderful. All right. The choir is going to sing for you. They salute to the armed forces. And if you serve, when you hear your song of the branch of the military you served in, we want you to stand up and remain standing, if you will, through the till the end of the song. And then we want to give you a hand. All right. So you listen in the appropriate time when your song comes on. You stand and we'll know what branch of the service you served in. Thank you for serving your country. Mm-hmm.
you. We really appreciate that. Really, really do. Would you turn with me, please, to 127, 127. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of green, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. 127. On that first together. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of green, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed good grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Let's sing that third. Oh, beautiful for hero true in liberating strife, who more than self and life. America, America, may God thy glory find, till all since that we nobleness and every gain divine. As we sing this last, we're going to have the children be dismissed to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church. Let's sing that last all together. Oh, beautiful for patriot dream that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster cities gleam undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Amen. That's great singing this morning. Would you turn over with me to number three? Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Would you stand with me, please, as we sing Amazing Grace. On that first together. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now on my heart to bear. Grace, my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. dangers, toils, and snares, through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis Christ that brought me, saved us far, and grace will that first verse one more time. We'll sing that without the instruments. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing grace,
how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Seated. Ushers will come and get our offering now today. Continue to give as God has blessed and prospered you. Our special offering we do twice a year. We do it in March and also in August. That'll be a month from today, August 7th. And that special offering that day, we had a fellow come out and measure. We're going to try to get some carpeting in this auditorium. Okay, it's well past due, and so that's what that'll go for on August 7th. So if you would plan on that, prepare, and pray, ask the Lord what he'd have you to do, and we'll trust God to meet that need come August 7th, okay? And I'd like to get that set up and get it done and have it set by missions conference time, which is coming up quickly, and that's exciting. All right, let's pray, and we'll ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. Brother Paul Label, I'd like you to lead us in our prayer, if you would, please.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us where we can come together and worship you and hear about your word as the preacher preaches it this morning. So we pray that you'd be with him and fill him with the spirit that you want to message so that each one of us can get just exactly what you want us to have today. And we pray for the offering that you would bless it and bless those that give. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
We have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. My great concern is not whether God is on our side. My great concern is to be on God's side.
Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Psalm 32:12. As you travel from sea to shining sea, it's obvious that God has blessed this great nation because our forefathers founded it on biblical principles. Throughout our history, we've had many presidents and leaders who acknowledged and sought guidance from God Almighty. George Washington, our first president, acknowledged our need for God when he said,
You do well to wish to learn our arts and ways of life, and above all the religion of Jesus Christ. These will make you a greater and happier people.
John Adams, who was the second president and instrumental in our nation's formative years, said,
We recognize no sovereign but God, and no king but Jesus.
And in October of 1798, penned these words,
Our Constitution was made only for a moral and religious people.
Thomas Jefferson, our third president, knew the importance of God's word when he announced, the Bible makes the best people in the world. The fourth president, James Madison, also acknowledged the importance of Scripture.
The future and success of America is not in this Constitution, but in the laws of God which this Constitution is founded.
John Quincy Adams served from 1825 to 1829, said,
The Bible is the first and almost the only book deserving of universal attention.
Andrew Jackson, the seventh president, held the Bible in high regards and declared,
That book, sir, is the rock on which our republic rests.
Franklin Pierce, the 14th president of our great nation, said,
I rely confidently on the continued gracious favor of Almighty God to maintain against all enemies, whether at home or abroad.
Andrew Johnson served from 1865 to 1869 and declared his faith by saying, I do believe in Almighty God, and I believe also in the Bible. Ulysses S. Grant, the great general and our 18th president, has this to say,
Hold fast to the Bible as the sheet anchor of your liberties. Write its precepts in your hearts and practice them in your lives.
William McKinley knew our need for the Almighty declared,
Our earnest prayer is that God will graciously vouchsafe prosperity, happiness, and peace to all our neighbors.
Theodore Roosevelt, the 26th president of our great land, announced,
A thorough knowledge of the Bible is worth more than a college education.
Woodrow Wilson declared our Christian heritage when he expressed,
America was born a Christian nation. America was born to exemplify that devotion to the elements of righteousness are derived from the revelations of Holy Scriptures.
He also said,
the Bible is the word of life. I beg that you will read it and find this out for yourself.
Calvin Coolidge stated,
the strength of our country is the strength of its religious convictions.
The 31st President of the United States, Herbert Hoover, said,
the study of the Bible is a postgraduate course in the richest library of human experience.
Franklin D. Roosevelt served from 1933 to 1945. While addressing the nation over the radio, he stated,
No greater thing could come to our land today than a revival of the spirit of religion.
Dwight D. Eisenhower, our 34th president, spoke these words during his 1957 inaugural address. The Bible is endorsed by the ages. Our civilization is built upon its words. On January 20th, 1961, our 35th president, John F. Kennedy, spoke at his inauguration.
Right to man, come not from the generosity of the state, but from the hand of God.
Ronald Reagan, the 40th president, warned America that
freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction.
We ever forget that we're one nation under God, then we will be a nation gone under.
It's obvious that the foundations upon which this country was founded have been abandoned by many today, and it's had a grave effect. A quick glance at the headlines will show you just how far we've strayed. But it's not too late for God to do a great work in America.
It's more important than ever that young people decide to do what's right. You have a choice to make. Will you allow America to continue on its current path, or will you decide this week to choose the Lord?
Video we saw, picked up from the youth conference at North Valley Baptist Church, and thought that was very appropriate for us to play that today. And you cannot deny, though they're trying to rewrite our history books in the schools, you cannot deny the presence of God in the founding of this country. And kids, don't take, if you're in public school or state school, don't take what they tell you as truth. You better search there. The truth is out there. You just have to search a little harder for it than what you normally would. Take your Bible this morning, if you would, to Romans 13. Romans chapter 13, please, for our scripture reading this morning. You can take that off. Romans 13. We're going to go ahead and read there's 14 verses. We're going to read all 14 verses this morning. We'll begin responsibly, as we normally do. I'll begin together on one, then we'll read two together, and we'll alternate reading till we end at verse number 14. As our custom is, let's stand together, read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word, and let's begin together on verse 1 of Romans 13. Ready? Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power resisteth the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain. For he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Wherefore ye must needs be subject, not only for wrath, but also for conscience' sake. For this cause pay ye tribute also. For they are God's ministers, attending continually upon this very thing. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. Owe no man anything but to love one another. For he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. For this, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet. And if there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in this saying, namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying. But put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lusts thereof. Let's pray. Father, add your blessing now to our reading of the scripture this morning. Lord, thank you so much for the wonderful music today. Lord, we do thank you for our country. Lord, I'm grateful and I'm thankful that I've had the privilege of growing up in the United States of America. Thank you for your hand upon this country through the years. And Lord, we must ask your forgiveness for our country and for our land, for having strayed away from you, having strayed away from the path you would have us to go. And I pray you would truly bring America back to God today. Lord, I pray that each of us would understand our part and what we ought to do. And I pray that you will prepare us now to receive the truth from your word this morning. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. We bow in prayer this morning, Lord. We again ask for your help now as we open up your word. We thank you, Lord, for the Bible. We heard various quotes of many of our presidents and what high regard and high esteem they had for your word. And I pray that each of us would give careful attention to the word of God this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of having copies of the word of God in our hand today. And I pray you'd speak to us now and help us as only you can. In Jesus' name, amen. The Bible makes it clear that we're citizens of another country. We sit up this morning and raise your hand for what state you were born in. And if anybody, when we went to Mexico on the missions trip, we had to declare, is that on one? That needs to be on one, otherwise it's too much, okay? The next to the bottom one there, Robert. Thank you. Perfect. Thank you. And they would declare your citizenship, and you would have to say American or United States. And the truth is, if this morning, as a believer, someone asks you to declare your citizenship, your response should be heaven. I'm a citizen of heaven if you know Christ as your Savior. Our citizenship is in heaven, the Bible says. The song is, this world is not my home, I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. So we're not of the world, but we certainly are in the world. And we live here, and we go about our business here, and the Lord has us here for however many years that He chooses that we're on this earth. And we have to relate to something called government. Okay, and what does the Bible say anything about a Christian and government? How should we relate to our government? And I got news for you. The Bible does say something about that. And Romans chapter 13 is where we learn some things about government. We learn from Romans 13, government has three primary roles. Government has three primary roles. Number one, government is to preserve order. Verse 1 says that of Romans 13, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. There is no power but of God, and the powers that be are ordained of God. The powers or the governments that be, the rulers that be, have been ordained by God. In other words, it's simply that God has ordained the fact that there be government, that there be order. And God is a God of order. And so He puts those orders and He puts those things and establishes those governments or establishes the institution of government. The second thing the government is for is to promote justice. Notice verses 3 and 4. Rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is a minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain. He is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Government is there to punish evildoers. That is proper, and that's a role of government. Government's to preserve order, to punish evildoers, and number three, to provide protection. That's why it says he executeth not the sword in vain, or beareth not the sword in vain. That's protection. The government is to protect us, and that's part of national defense, if you will. It's to provide protection for its people. The preamble to the Constitution of the United States states this, quote, the government is to ensure domestic tranquility, provide common defense, promote general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty. John Adams, who you heard quoted earlier, said, we have no government armed with power capable of contending with human passions unbridled by morality and religion. Understand what he said? He said, our Constitution is not set up to handle people whose passions are not bridled, held back by morality and religion. Are we there? Yeah. It's totally inadequate to have a people that don't fear God, and don't have some moral restraint placed on them by God. In other words, if you don't want, if you don't, the Constitution was made that there's a people that want to do good. There's a people that want to love their neighbor as themselves. And if that's not the case, he said the Constitution will not work. And that's why we're having difficulty in our day. Our Constitution was made for a moral and religious people. It's wholly inadequate to the government of any other. John Adams, first vice president and second U.S. president. Now, the purpose of the Constitution, as many of you know, was to limit the role of the federal government. In other words, it's a list of what the government should not do, not what it should do. All right? It's what it cannot do. In other words, the phrase that you see over and over is, Congress shall have the power to, and then it'll list something. In other words, if it isn't spelled out what Congress has the power to do, then they do not have the power to do it. That's what it's doing. It's limiting. Articles 1, 2, and 3 of the Constitution deal with the Congress, the office of the President, and the Supreme Court. It limits their powers. It's called the balance of the powers. And that's the way the founders set it up. Then we have what's called the Bill of Rights. I'll tell you, the Bill of Rights was adopted December 15th, 1791. The first 10 amendments to the Constitution were ratified by the states. The Bill of Rights was added to the Constitution to address the fears by the anti-federalists during the ratification of the Constitution that the Constitution didn't provide enough protection from the federal government. And so James Madison, the father of the Constitution, originally didn't think the Bill of Rights was necessary. He thought the Constitution gave no power to the federal government that would allow for a violation of the rights of the people, but he later changed his position, persuaded by Thomas Jefferson, and helped draft the 20 amendments that were proposed to the first United States Congress in 1789. 12 of the amendments were accepted by Congress, sent to the states for ratification. 10 of those 12 were ratified, and those 10 amendments list our basic rights, and they place limits on the federal government. They include freedom of speech, freedom of religion, the right to bear arms, the right to be free from unreasonable searches and seizures, an assurance that the powers that not delegated to the federal government in the Constitution are to be reserved to the states and to the people. Many of the provisions were based on similar protections provided by state constitutions. The rest of the amendments to the Constitution were not ratified in 1791, and the 27th was adopted in 1992. The Bill of Rights illustrates that our founding fathers understood our personal freedoms were vital. Our personal freedoms were important, and that the power of the federal government had to be limited. Now, you have to be living in a cave for the last 50 years to know that we've gone way beyond that. And we have a federal government that has much more power than what the founding fathers ever envisioned it would have. Most of you know Amendment 1 says Congress will make no law respecting the establishment of a religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of the people to peaceably assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. Amendment 2 is a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state. The right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. Amendment 4, the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrant shall issue but upon probable cause supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the persons or things to be seized. You see, each one limits what the government is able to do. Now, I got some shocking statistics for you. As of May 2016, There are just over 22 million federal, state, and local government employees. 22 million. The federal government, this is hard to wrap your head around a little bit. The federal government paid $2,007,358,200,000 in benefits and entitlements in 2013. That's the most recent year I could find. The total budget is $3,454,253,000,000. That was 2013. I'm not sure what it is now. It's probably a lot more. But at that time, listen, benefits and entitlements total 58% of the budget. Did you know that 55% of U.S. households receive some form of a government check every month? You understand what that means? That means there's 45% working to pay those 55%. And my friend, it doesn't take a mathematician to figure out that ain't going to work. That isn't going to hold up very long. When too many are dependent on a government funded by too few, the system will collapse. And there are those in our country, not outside of our country, but inside of our country, that would love to see it collapse. And they have taken steps to see that happen. They have taken steps to overwhelm the system and to see it go under. But we have a government that has left God and gone its own way. There's no doubt about it. Certainly, the attack is on Christians. You will not hear of a lesbian or homosexual couple suing a Muslim bakery for not baking them a cake. But they'll sue the Christian for not doing it for them. You won't hear any of that kind of discrimination. It's always against the believer. It's always against Christianity. No doubt about it. But you have to understand, when Paul penned Romans 13, Nero was in charge of the Roman government. Paul was writing this, and at the time, the law had been passed in Rome that Christianity was illegal. Could not be practiced. Jesus was crucified by the Roman government. You understand, the Jews didn't crucify people. Rome crucified people. Homosexuality was rampant among the Roman leaders in government. That's the government that's in charge when Paul writes this. And by the way, he's writing it. This what's the name of this book called? The book we just read, chapter 13? Romans. To the Christians that are in Rome. Underneath Nero. Underneath this, what they would certainly say was a corrupt government. And so what's our response, by the way? So is there corruption in government? Absolutely. Do we have godless rulers? Yes, we do. Do we have those in positions they ought not to be in that want the detriment and the downfall of the United States of America? Yes, I think we do. So what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to complain, and we're supposed to call talk radio, or we're supposed to sign petitions, or we're supposed to march on Washington? We're supposed to just complain and air our grievances out to anybody we meet? Is that the response of believers? What are we supposed to do with our government? Well, Paul answers that here in Romans 13. We're going to look at it this morning. Number one, here's what he says our response should be. Number one is a submissive spirit. Notice verse 1, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. For there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Verse number 5, wherefore you must needs be subject, not only for wrath, but also for conscience sake. There's no power but of God. God has allowed that power and has put that office there in the institution of government to be there. Ungodly examples are to be obeyed, but they are not to be copied. Remember what he told his disciples about the scribes and the Pharisees? He says, look at Matthew, I think it's Matthew 23. Matthew 23. He is, he's talking to the Pharisees here, and he says in verse number 23 of Matthew 23, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. Now look, these ought ye to have done, and not to leave undone. Ye blind guides would strain a gnat and swallow the camel." And he goes on to talk about these Pharisees and all that they are, and they're full of dead men's bones. But he went on to tell his disciples that, listen, you do as they tell you to do, but don't be like they are. All that they bid you observe, observe and do, but don't follow their example. Don't be like them. The Bible says in Romans 13 that we're supposed to pay taxes. So I don't think you ought to pay taxes. Well, you go ahead and try that. Let me know how that works out for you. Okay, but the Bible makes it plain in verse 7, "Render therefore to all their dues. Tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor." Jesus put it this way, "Render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and to God the things which are God's." And so our job is not to resist the power. Did you notice verse number 2 when we read Romans 13? "Whosoever therefore resisteth." What's the word "resist" mean? Yeah, to go against. It literally means to stand against something. There's only one thing in the Bible that the Bible says a Christian is to resist. Resist the devil and he'll flee. What does that mean? Stand against the devil. Okay, here it says, don't stand against the power. "For whoever stands against the power stands against the ordinance of God, and they that stand against shall receive to themselves damnation." Those are powerful words. So we're not resisting the power. Our job as believers is not to stand against the government. We're not to promote anarchy. And everybody does what's right in their own eyes. There is law in the government. Now, you say, well, preacher, what happens if they tell us to do something that violates God's law? Then you obey the higher power. And the higher power is God. When they were arrested and they told the disciples, don't preach anymore in His name, they said, whether you think that's right or not, you'll be the judge of that. But we ought to obey God rather than man. We have a higher mandate than you. We're going to obey God, and we're going to do what God says. And so you have to have a submissive spirit. You don't want to get into having a rebellious spirit, because that affects other areas of your life, and you don't want to be that way. So you have to have a submissive spirit. Number two, the Bible then says, Paul says, you have to have a loving spirit. What do you say in verse 8? "Owe no man anything but to love one another. For he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law." We shouldn't need a government telling us how to treat people. That's unbelievable. That's not the role of government. We ought to know why, because we fulfill the law. We know that we ought to love our neighbor as ourselves. We say, well, you should treat others as you'd like to be treated. Well, what is that? That's the golden rule. That's in the Bible. But you see, we get away from the Bible, we get away from God's law, and we don't know how to treat each other. We need a loving spirit. You know, Galatians 5:18 says, if you're led of the Spirit, then you are not under the law. In other words, if I'm led by the Spirit of God, and the fruit of the Spirit is in my life, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, faith, what do I need a law telling me how to treat people? I don't need a law. See, that's not necessary. If the law is to keep people who don't have any restraint on themselves. And so we want to have a loving spirit. Titus chapter 3. 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and then Titus. Titus chapter 3, another one of the young preachers that Paul was training for the ministry. Look at Titus 3 in verse 1, will you? Titus was in a difficult place. He was on the island of Crete. And he tells Titus this, verse 1, put them in mind to be subject to principalities and powers, to obey magistrates, to be ready to every good work, to speak evil of no man, to be no brawlers, but gentle, showing all meekness unto all men. Now wait a minute. We've taken verse 2 before and say, speak evil of no man, and don't be a brawler, and be gentle, and have all meekness. But in the context of what he just saying, who is he talking about? He's talking about the people he mentioned in verse 1. He's talking about magistrates. He's talking about principalities. He's talking about powers. He's talking about those in authority. Don't speak evil of them. And I would dare say that most of us have been guilty of that. We talk evil about them. Or to be brawlers. Clean them out. Man, we get that, give me a pitchfork and a torch and I'm going after them. And we get that mentality. We say, no, you're going to show gentleness. Gentleness is that softness in manners. That meekness is the ability to get along with others without causing friction. See, so, and by the way, both gentleness and meekness are fruit of the Spirit, being a Spirit-filled Christian. You see, a lot of the problems we have and the difficulties we face is twofold. People who have gotten away from God completely and they're just completely ruled by the flesh. But we also have believers who are not being led by the Spirit. Believers are not living under the influence of the Spirit. And we can easily conform to the world in the area of our politics. And react the way they react. And live the and respond the way they respond. Without stopping and thinking, wait a minute. Is this what God wants me to do? Is this how God would want me to respond? Don't have a disconnect when it comes to your Christianity and your spirituality and then your politics. Don't disconnect those two. You listen. Your spirituality is 10,000 times more important than your patriotism. And sometimes we blur the two. And we think, well, if you're patriotic, you're spiritual. Be careful. We've blurred those lines a little bit in our churches, thinking one is proof of the other, and it isn't. So we're not to compromise, but we're not to antagonize either. And so, speak evil of no man. Those are powerful words. And we have to be careful. And I'll say more about that in just a little bit. Over in 2 Peter 2 and verse 10, I'll just read this verse for you. The Bible, I'm sorry, I got 1 Peter. I want 2 Peter. 2 Peter 2:10. The Bible says this. Chiefly they that talk about ungodly people, they that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government. Presumptuous are they, self-willed, not they are not afraid to speak evil of dignities. characteristic of someone who's not right with God. But to be careful, that we check our spirit, that we have a loving spirit. So Paul said, here's how you respond to a corrupt government. Here's how you respond to a government that's against you. You have a submissive spirit. You have a loving spirit. Number three, he says you're to have a prayerful spirit. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 2 with me, will you? 1 Timothy chapter 2. Now, you may disagree with the message today, but you'll have to disagree with the Bible. I'm just telling you what God's Word says. I mean, if Paul wanted you to march or sign petitions or anything like that, he had a great opportunity to take care of it right here in Romans 13. Here he tells Timothy, I exhort, look at verse 1, I exhort therefore that first of all, now when the Bible says something first of all, I guess there must be some order of importance here. You agree? If you say, you're talking to someone and say, I have several things I want you to do. Now first, I want you to do this. And then I want you to do this, and then I want you to do this. What do you think you should do first? Whatever he said first, right? So you notice what he said? First of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority. Wow. You know why? You know why we complain and we gripe and we criticize and we speak evil of our leaders? Because we don't, first of all, offer prayers and supplications and intercessions and giving of thanks. Be made for them. Guilty. We, you know, be not conformed to the world, be ye transformed. We kind of conform in that area. And we fall in like everybody else. You know, when's the last time you've been in a group and somebody starts griping about the government or griping about the president? What would happen if you said, hey, fellas, you know what I think we should do? I think we should bow our heads and let's pray for them right now. That's what the Bible says we should do. Say, boy, that would break the meeting up, wouldn't it? A prayerful spirit. You never, listen, we'll never get a submissive spirit, we'll never get a loving spirit if we don't have a praying spirit. We resist because we do not pray. James 4, what happens in James 4 when he talks about you desire and you fight and you war, but you never give what you want. Why? Because you have not, because you ask not. You don't pray. So you have to resort to fighting and arguing and yelling and screaming and calling names and criticizing. Because we don't pray. We don't pray. Notice it says that those supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made. What's the word after made? For all men. About all men. Against all men. I'm praying for the president. I'll tell you what I'm praying. No. Don't pray about him. Don't pray against him. Pray for him. You ought to be praying for his salvation. For his turning to God. A submissive spirit, a loving spirit, a prayerful spirit. Go back to Romans 13 now with me, will you please? The Bible says we're to have a Christ-like spirit. Notice verse 11, and that knowing the time. And by the way, when he said knowing the time, what time is it? I don't mean it's 5 till 12. Okay? What time is it? It is the last time. It is time for Christ to return. I mean, I know other generations have thought this was it, and I've lived through some of those times when people were just convinced this is when Jesus is coming. And I don't know. Maybe he'll wait another 100 years. I don't know how, But he can do whatever he wants to do. But surely the way the world is lining up and the condition of things that we're seeing, and surely it's coming soon. Knowing the time. It's now high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. The night is far spent. The day at his hand. Let us therefore cast off the work of darkness and put on the armor of light. Here's what we do, Christians. We walk honestly as in the day. We don't get caught up in rioting and drunkenness, chambering and wantonness, strife and envy. We don't live after the flesh. We don't get caught up and live just like everybody else. That's the difficulty, and that's really the problem in America. Listen, I'm for everybody who starts a church and plants a church, and we need more good, solid, Bible-believing, Bible-preaching churches. But listen to me, when we say we've got so many millions of Christians in the United States of America, why aren't we making more of an impact than what we're making? Because we have believers who are caught up in chambering and wantonness, in riotous living and in drunkenness, and in living as they want to live. We have churches that, because it's July 4th tomorrow, won't have church Sunday night. And we think we're going to impact the world for Jesus Christ? No, I'd rather barbecue on Sunday night because it's a holiday. And you won't go about another 12 weeks or maybe 10 weeks, and it's Labor Day, so we'll have another night off. Get me started on that. So what'd he say? Verse 14. Put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lusts thereof. Put on the Lord. We're living in the nighttime. The night is far spent. We're in a dark time. But whenever it's dark, the brighter the light ought to shine. So let the light shine. And it's not, listen, it's really a letting Christ's light shine through me. He is the light of the world. Sometimes I get so much junk in my life, and we get so much junk in our lives, it obscures the light. We don't march, we don't complain, we don't protest, we don't have to boycott, we don't have to pass laws so sinners won't sin. It's not the answer. What's the answer? Live differently than this world lives. Live differently than people who don't know God. It's really pretty basic. Now, I'll give it to you. It's easier to complain. It's easier to gripe. It's easier to just get a sign and go protest with somebody than it is to live godly and put on the Lord Jesus and don't make provision for the flesh. God would have spared Sodom if there were 10 righteous people. Just 10 righteous people. That's what he's looking for. I wonder if he has a number for America. I wonder if he has a number. If he has a number, are you part of that number? That video ended today with, you decide. Our decision isn't November is who's going to be another president. The decision America is going to have to make, and decision God's people have to make, is, am I going to be an out-and-out Christian, or am I going to keep playing around with it? What am I going to do? Am I going to respond in the right way? Am I going to determine I'm going to, God, give me a loving spirit. God, give me a submissive spirit. God, give me a prayerful spirit. God, give me a Christ-like spirit. One of these protest rallies, the other day, I don't know if you've seen it or not, there's a fellow with a sign up. You know what he said? If Jesus is coming again, let's kill him again. Oh, yeah. Big sign. In America. You have to understand, folks, when you're like Christ, the world will hate you. You won't be popular with the world. But God will be pleased with you. And we're here to please God. Amen. So we have to put on the armor of light, cast off the works of darkness. We put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Now that doesn't mean, listen, that means we don't have a negative, defeatist attitude. As a American, I hate what's happening to our country. As a Christian, I'm excited about what's happening to our country. Because it is fitting into God's plan. I can see what God's doing. I read the book. I know what's going to take place. And I can't let my Americanism override my Christianity. I have to know where my loyalties lie. Titus 2:13 says we're to be looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. There's hope. And the hope's not the White House. The hope is in Jesus Christ. The hope is He's coming again. And He's going to set up His rule and reign. Benjamin Franklin said this, I've lived, sir, a long time, and the longer I live, and the more convincing proofs I see of this truth, that God governs in the affairs of men, and if a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without His notice, is it probable that an empire can rise without His aid? We have been assured, sir, in the sacred writings, that except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. I firmly believe this, and I also believe that without His concurring aid, we shall succeed in this political building no better than the builders of Babel. If we don't get the aid of God, He said, we'll build nothing more than they built at the Tower of Babel. It'll amount to nothing. Bobby Richardson was a second baseman for the New York Yankees back in the day, early 1960s, maybe some in the 50s. But he was one of the first outspoken Christian athletes. And he was offering a prayer at the close of one of the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, and it's been recorded for its classic brevity as he prayed. Here's what he prayed that day. He said, Dear God, Your will, nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. Amen. Would you be willing to say that prayer? Dear Lord, Your will, nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. It's the only hope we got. We're going to see a revival in America. It's not too late, folks. God has done, if you haven't followed this revival down in Burlington, North Carolina, God's doing a great work. Amazing thing in Burlington, North Carolina. You look under New Hope Baptist Church or Burlington Tent Revival. You search for that, and you'll see where they put a big tent up. They've had revival going on since May 8th. They're going to go through this next week, which will be July 8th. I think Friday night, Bob said they had 3,000 under the tent. They've had over 500 people saved. The other night, lady paid a plane ticket, flew her adult son up from Florida. Been praying for him, was it 40 years, Bob, or something like that? He walked the aisle and got saved Friday night. And him and his mom hugging each other at the altar. Tears flowing down. God's bringing revival. God's doing great things. Had 188 preachers in the meeting Friday night. That's revival right there. I don't think it's too late, my friend. I think it's too late. It just takes a group of people that'll say, God's will. Nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. Let's have the right response to government. It's not political in nature. It's spiritual in nature. Let's make sure we're being what we should be. The before God. Let's pray, shall we, Father? Thank you for the Apostle Paul and the words that you gave to him here in Romans 13. Lord, I'm asking you this morning to speak to our hearts. We want to do what we can and what you would want us to do to help our nation back to you. Lord, you said when you begin judgment, you'll begin at the house of God. It starts right here where we are. Lord, I pray you'd forgive us this morning for strife and envying and just getting caught up with the American life, not making an impact in our world for Christ, in our country for Christ, in our city, in our neighborhood. Oh, God, help us to say your will, God. Nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. I wonder how many folks here this morning would say, Pastor, you know, if I died this morning, I know for sure that I'd go to heaven. There's a time in my life when I know that I was a sinner and I needed a Savior, and Jesus was the Savior I needed, and I trusted Him as my Savior. And Pastor, I know for sure that when I take my last breath here, my next breath will be in heaven. Here's my hand as a testimony. Will you slip it up that I may see it? Say, Pastor, I know that I'm saved. All right, you may put it down. You hear this morning would say, Pastor, I don't know that for sure. I don't know if I died, I'd go to heaven. I don't know where I'd go. But wouldn't you like to know you're going to heaven? There's nothing greater in all the world than knowing, having the peace in your heart, that you're at peace with God. And that if anything would happen to you, you'd wake up in heaven. Would you let me pray for you? We'll not embarrass you in any way, but I'll pray for you. And you say, Pastor, I appreciate you praying for me. I'm not certain about my eternity. I'm not certain where I'd go when I die. But I would like you to pray for me. Would you slip your hand up for a minute and then put it back down? That I'll see it? You couldn't raise it the first time, but you'll raise it now. Is there someone like that? Let me pray for you this morning. The message was to believers today. I don't know if you've maybe not had a very submissive spirit, maybe not a very loving spirit, maybe not a prayerful spirit, a Christ-like spirit. But today you'd be willing to say, Pastor, I understand my responsibility, what my response to government ought to be. And Pastor, this morning, my prayer to God will be your will. Nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. I want to live and respond the way God tells me to. Will you slip your hand up this morning, Christian? Say, that'll be me. That's my decision today. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him. Just kneel at the altar and just tell God what He's told you. Respond to Him. If you're here today and you've never received Christ as your Savior, when the others are coming to pray, you just come. I'll be here at the front. We have people who've been trained. They'll take a Bible and they'll show you from the Bible how you can know you're on your way to heaven. If you're here today and you're saved and you've ever been scripturally baptized, you ought to come and say, you know what, I need to be obedient and be baptized. If you're saved and you're baptized and you believe this is where you ought to belong, then you come and say, Preacher, we want to serve the Lord here. And we'd be glad to welcome you into the fellowship of our church. Whatever it is your need is this morning, you just obey the Lord. Father in heaven, bless this invitation. May your will be done now in each and every heart this morning. Thank you for speaking to hearts today. Lord, I pray that you'd hear our prayer that we make around these altars today. And Lord, may we make a difference. Just the people in this room can make a difference. So have your way, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Bob will sing. God has spoken to your heart this morning. I want you to respond to Him.
Have thine own way, Lord. That's right. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. As in thy presence, humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway. Fill with thy spirit till all shall see Christ only always living in me.
Father in heaven, we bow before you now. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us. Thank you for being our God. We're so thankful that we know Christ is our Savior. We're thankful for the country you've given us, for the freedoms that we still enjoy. Lord, I pray that you'd help us to live as you would have us to live in this day and age. Lord, that we would resist Satan and we would put off the works of darkness. And we'd put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And other people would see Christ in our lives. Lord, I pray that he would be lifted up in each one of our lives this week. Father, thank you for a wonderful service here this morning. I'm glad I was in the house of the Lord today. Dismiss us now with your care. Give us a good afternoon. Prepare us what you have for us this evening. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Do you have God Bless America handy or not? Can you find that? Got in there? I think usually we sing Family of God. Let's sing God Bless America for our closer today, all right? You come across it? She's got it, Brother Bob.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans, wipe us love. God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home.
Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.